Welcome to our expo and the second part of our expo in nuclear science and engineering. My name is Anne White. I'm the department head for those of you who don't know me. We've just had a fantastic poster session taking us on a journey through the foundations and the frontiers of our discipline. And it's a tremendously exciting moment to be here and getting ready to hear these talks. I'm just really inspired because I think about foundations and frontiers and what does it really mean, and it means playing to our strengths. We're scientists, we're engineers, it's true. And there's an interesting frontier though, which is communication, not just to each other, but to members of the public about the tremendous benefit that can be derived from responsible use of nuclear science and technology for the good of the world. So thank you all for the presentations, the posters today. It was wonderful. And I hope that all of you have taken a quick peek at the back of your sheet here with a QR code where you can all vote on your favorite poster. Please do that. Give some fantastic feedback to our community who spent a lot of time preparing them. And before I turn it over to the host for the signature talks, Professor Mingde Li, I just want to say a very quick thank you to some very important people who put this whole event together. So thank you, Anne Dulong, to Marina, thank you to Mingde, thank you also to Baritza and to Rob for helping everything go off without a hitch, and thank you to Ilovino for producing some very beautiful handouts for everyone. So with that, thank you. Mingde, I'll let you take over as host. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anne, and thank you, everyone. So as we all can see, so why we have this wonderful event and bringing people together. You can see that this pandemic and people are separated everywhere, and we can only see each other from Zoom until we have hosting this giant event. So you can learn from each other on the different state-of-the-art research going on in our department. So it's a very great opportunity, and today we have four signature talks. So representing this research frontier in quantum research, that includes the favorite this material diamond by Guoqing, also the favorite material for my wife as well. And other than that, we also have the signature talks in like hydrodynamics and nuclear fission and fusion. So besides the technical aspects, so hope we can also see about this communication, the power of communication and presentation. And with that, I will leave all the presentation for Guoqing, and welcome our first speaker. Thank you.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, Mingde, for the nice introduction. So who likes diamond? And who likes super powerful quantum computers? Okay, so today I have a good news for you. So we can combine both. So quantum is actually a very promising research area in recent years, and diamond is familiar to everyone. You might be interested in, does diamond have anything to do with quantum? The answer is clearly yes. So today, it is a great honor for me to introduce some of our recent research updates about developing highly sensitive sensors and more powerful simulators using diamond. So let's start from a very famous story in quantum physics, which is Schrodinger's cat. So that in classical world, a cat can be either alive or dead. However, this is not the case in quantum world. So in the quantum world, a cat can be both alive and dead at the same time. And we call this superposition principle. And the smallest unit in the nature to actually preserve such a superposition is called a qubit. So the most powerful thing about qubit is its powerful applications, such as in quantum computation. So people in Google have demonstrated that using 54 qubits, we can achieve the computation of some task within 200 seconds, which requires more than 10,000 years for classical computers. And in quantum sensing, people have demonstrated that using a single qubit, you can sense the magnetic property of some material in nanoscale with high sensitivity. And in quantum simulation, people also demonstrated using a lot of qubits to actually create versatile platform to simulate some novel matters. So in this talk, I will focus on sensing and simulation. So the qubit that we are using is actually a defect in diamond. So such a defect is called nitrogen vacancy center, or NV center. So NV center is actually very like a magnetic needle, which is sensitive to magnetic field. Moreover, it is also a qubit. So how do we control such a qubit? How do we use this qubit to actually perform our quantum sensing and simulation task? So let's start from this example. So assume that we have a signal field, which is actually an oscillating, for example, magnetic field. If the signal field has a frequency omega zero, which actually match this energy gap of this qubit level, then this signal field will introduce some oscillation or transition between the two qubit states, zero and one. And such a transition is called Rabi oscillation. So if you observe this time evolution of this Rabi oscillation, we see this periodic oscillation signal. So on the one hand, we can use such an oscillation to control the qubit state. On the other hand, by observing the oscillation frequency, we can extract the strength of the signal field. So this is the principle that we will use in sensing magnetic field in this work. So currently for quantum sensing, there have been a lot of applications developed, such as in sensing electric and magnetic fields, in sensing a rotation, and in sensing temperature in some biomaterials. And recently, in our group, some colleagues also developed a diamond to actually sense a COVID, which is quite interesting. And all these applications have been achieved with nanoscale resolution and less than picotesla sensitivity for magnetic field sensing. However, there are still a few challenges that we want to overcome before we apply it to more broadened applications. So the first challenge that we want to deal with is that current methods are only limited to sensing only one component of 3D field. Assume you have a vector field with both transverse and longitudinal component, most current methods are only applicable to sensing only one component. So to overcome this challenge, we propose that we can use the rotating frame. The rotating frame is actually a frame that has a rotation, for example, about z-axis. So assume you have a transverse component which has one frequency, and in the rotating frame, the transverse component will have a frequency shift, while the longitudinal component does not. Secondly, we have a tunable energy gap in the rotating frame. Remember that to sense some magnetic field, we need to tune the qubit energy gap to the signal frequency. So now we have a tunable energy gap. We can tune it to different component frequencies, and then we can extract the strength for different components separately. So this is the principle for sensing vectorial fields. The second challenge is that, remember that we need the signal frequency to be on resonance with your qubit frequency, qubit energy. So actually, we have quite limited frequency range. So what we do is that to achieve a measurement of arbitrary frequency fields, we can convert any unmeasurable frequencies to measurable frequency range. Remember that if you have a signal applied to the NV center, it will drive Rabi oscillation only when it's on resonance. However, now if we apply a second oscillating field, which we call it bias frequency, and under both signal and bias frequencies, actually, the NV center will effectively see this signal frequency, which is actually the difference between the signal and bias frequency. So actually from this, we actually achieve a frequency conversion. So we convert our measurable frequency to the measurable range. So combining both the method of measuring vectorial fields and measuring arbitrary frequency fields, here we show a demonstration using our NV center in our lab. So this is the small picture showing the picture of our setup, and this is a zoom-in schematic. So we use a straight copper wire to apply a magnetic field to be sensed, and we use single NV center in a bulk diamond to actually map out the vectorial fields generated by this straight copper wire. So here we show that we measure Rabi oscillation. So from the Rabi oscillation frequency, we can extract the different component. And then we show the spatial distribution of the magnetic field generated by this copper wire, which is quite consistent with the classical model. So above, we have introduced our recent progress on quantum sensing. So now let's turn to quantum simulation. So why do we need quantum simulation? Because sometimes some phenomena is hard to observe in nature. For example, if you want to observe some magnetic monopole, probably it does not exist in nature. However, in a recent work published by our group, some colleagues by our group, actually we showed that we can use a diamond to actually synthesize some monopole source, to actually observe some monopole. Also, in quantum materials, sometimes it might be difficult to actually grow some material with desired symmetry. However, if you have some simulator, quantum simulator, we can actually engineer and characterize these quite interesting symmetries, for example, using diamond. So this is another example showing this demonstration. So you see that actually in different platforms, typically people need to design different methods to measure and characterize these things. So what we want to do is that we want to develop a generic protocol, which is general to most quantum information platforms, not just for diamond, but also for other platforms. So what we do is that assume we have some spatial symmetry in spatial domain, we can map such a spatial symmetry to the time domain. And in the time domain, actually we can use the microwave modulation to actually engineer different types of symmetries. So here this is a schematic showing that by applying this modulated drive, actually in the rotating frame, we can engineer parity symmetry, rotational symmetry, and particle hole symmetry. And to characterize this symmetry, we use the Rabi oscillation we have introduced. And by analyzing the frequency component in this time evolution, we can actually map out what kind of symmetry you have in your system. So here we show an example of the observation of the symmetry in our experiment, which actually you see that this vanishing amplitude associated with these dashed lines are actually an observation of the parity, rotation, and the particle hole symmetry. Okay, so above we have introduced our recent progress both on quantum sensing and simulation, so what's our next step? So currently, on the application side, we are still trying to improve the sensitivity of our sensor. So we are trying to enhance this lifetime of this sensor. For example, here this is an ongoing work. We achieve a factor of 20 improvement of the lifetime of the qubit so that this is useful for building better gyroscope or quantum memories. And also, we are studying the temperature and strain dependence of the quantum defects so that we can apply it to sensing biomaterials, characterizing electronics, and also in high-pressure applications. And in the fundamental physics side, on the one hand, remember that the diamond, we can use the diamond as a single qubit probe to actually probe this very interesting phenomena in quantum materials. And on the other hand, the diamond can also be used as a simulator to actually engineer this quite interesting, for example, this synthetic space in time domain or frequency domain. We can actually engineer this interesting lattice structure and study topological phases in this lattice structure. So when we combine diamond with quantum, we can actually develop highly sensitive sensors and more powerful simulators. So finally, I want to thank my advisor, Professor Paola Capolaro, and these works are also in collaboration with Professor Zhu Li and Dr. Daniel Brady in MIT Lincoln Lab, and all of these results are a very good, a nice team collaboration. With that, I want to thank you for your attention and happy to take any questions.
So any questions from the audience? Yes, please.
So I could see from your slide, perhaps you mentioned this, I missed it, but how do you achieve the 20 times improvement in the lifetime of the
sensor? Yes. Okay. So yeah, you are asking about this picture. Yeah, so actually for this, improvement of a coherence is actually a very important task, not just in quantum sensing, but also in quantum simulation, all the quantum platforms. So what we do typically in experiment is that we first characterize what's the decoherence mechanism for this. So for this, for example, here we are using an ensemble of NV center rather than only a single NV center. So in an ensemble of NV center, you actually have some spatial distribution, for example, for the temperature, strain, or static magnetic field. That will be the decoherence mechanism. So after knowing that decoherence mechanism, we can, according to what kind of mechanism it is, we design some coherence protection method. So for here, we actually use a principle which is similar to some spin echo to actually refocus those inhomogeneity sources. Yep. Yes.
Any other questions from the audience? Okay. If not, so let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.